So it's about obesity, and I think it's relevant for this discussion, and how to maintain a weight loss. That's the business here. So is that important? And I love this. I love this figure here. It's absolutely stunning. So this is the direct study from Mike Lean and Ian Taylor. And I'm sure you all know it, but the essence of it is that if you lose weight, there is a good chance that you may have remission of diabetes, and remission is here defined as 6.5% A1C. And this is the really stunning thing here, that if you have a weight loss, which is more than 15%, then you can expect this 86% remission rate. And this is, of course, extremely interesting and has spurred a discussion out there in the general population of whether what kind of a disease type 2 diabetes is, and if all that you have to do is to eat a little bit more healthy food, and you know, then it goes away. And is this really true? And there's a big public debate about this. It's really exciting. But this is, yes, you should lose weight, and it's not difficult to lose weight. We've tried it a couple of times. This was an old study we did, also Steen and Signe Tuorco and me, in 2015. And so what we did was to give them an eight-week low-calorie diet, and that resulted in a weight loss of 12%. And you can do that all the time, and everybody responded with a weight loss. I mean, there was not a single participant that didn't lose this kind of weight. We had a dietitian out there at Vidal. She was particularly effective, and we thought that this was all because of her. But actually, it turns out that you can do it every time. I mean, it works always. The problem is what goes after, of course. So what did you do? What can you do? And in this trial, we gave the people 1.2 milligrams of liraglutide. And this is what happened, and you can see it here. So this value obviously is the same one as the one after the acute weight loss. So we said it's maintained, but of course something happens here. The real parameter in that study was the number of meal replacements, because they were all allowed to use meal replacements of this Cambridge diet thing. But it turns out that those in the control group, they had a lot of meal replacements, and those in the liraglutide group, they didn't have any really. So there was a big difference here, and it worked. And in principle, the study that I'm going to show now should have been with liraglutide 1.2, but the Novo Nordisk wouldn't support it. They demanded that we use the 3 milligram dose, the Saxenda dose for that. Well, why is it so difficult to maintain this weight loss? Why is it so difficult? And so here, this is the key to it. And this is a study by Eric Ravoussin, he's French originally, I think, from Pennington. And he has several studies, and there are many of them. But it shows that there is a close linear relationship between energy expenditure and body weight. That is the basic fact of this. So if you lose weight, then your energy expenditure falls. And that's the problem. So body weight falls, energy expenditure decreases until a new steady state has been reached where there's a balance between the intake and the expense. That's what happens. So if you have a drop in expenditure here that follows the weight loss, but then what happens is that the energy efficiency increases at the same time. So the every calorie you take in, it works simply better in the body. So if you have a 10% weight loss, then to maintain that, you must reduce your energy intake by also 10%. This is what this says. But also, you have to account for the improved efficiency of the nutrients, so that you will have to reduce your energy intake by perhaps 15%. So that's the punishment of people that lose weight. You have to stop eating, and you have to stay there, down by 15%. That's terrible. 15% reduction in food intake is terrible. And at the same time, you'll suffer an increased hunger. So what do you do about this? These are the facts that we have to fight. So the main problems is the decreased energy expenditure and the increased appetite. What can we do? And one thing, of course, is to use exercise. Then you can increase the energy expenditure again and then eat a little bit more, hopefully. So this is what WHO recommends, 150 minutes a week of moderate or 75 minutes per week of vigorous intensity, or a combination and so forth. So is that a possibility? And we've already discussed that on the good things, the weight loss or maintenance, fat mass down, lean mass up, cardiorespiratory fitness up. And the other problem with the appetite could then be dealt with a GLP-1 receptor agonist. That's how it works. Decreases appetite, and then that will hopefully help. So this is what came out of it. And so it's not every day that you have a study accepted in the New England Journal of Medicine, and that's why I think it would be interesting to show the results. This was fairly recent that it finally appeared. After they had changed it a million times, it's really a painful process. So I don't wish for any of you to try to publish in the New England Journal of Medicine. It's terrible. Well, it was a one-year treatment with an exercise program, the large dose of liraglutide, or the combination, compared to placebo for healthy weight loss maintenance after weight loss induced by a low-calorie diet. And the primary endpoint was the change in body weight, of course, and the secondary was a change in body fat percentage, and then some metabolic health-related outcomes. And so here are the participants, and it's a large study. They occupied Allstein's laboratories for several years. I have highlighted here, what happened? Well, I think I'll try to go back. Let's see what happens now. Let's see what happens. Yeah, that worked. So here they have a BMI of 37 and a high fat percentage. Normally it's below 20 or something like that. So that's what characterizes them. And also, I can't help pointing at this. That's their maximum oxygen uptake. It's 22 milliliters per kilogram per minute. That's low. That's low. It's one of the key characteristics of this population. They have a low oxygen uptake. Okay, so this is the 250 individuals, and they were randomized, and they had this low-calorie diet and lost a lot of weight, and then they were randomized to placebo or placebo plus exercise, liraglutide 3 milligrams, and liraglutide plus exercise. And then after this 52 weeks, we looked at what happened. And they did it well, these young people that took care of the exercise. They really did a good job. And you can see that because here we have the exercise duration over all these 52 weeks, and it's maintained at around 120 to 140 minutes per week, and it's pretty high intensity. As you can see here, the intensity here, which was recorded at all times. So everything was done to make sure that this worked. And even if you already said that it was terrible in the last half, it was. But they were very, keen at keep maintaining people at it. And as you can see, it worked. It worked. So so these are the results. So what happened was that this big initial weight loss, everybody managed to do that. And then we had the four groups, and you can see that the placebo group, as expected, regains weight. Even if, you talk to them, you do everything, but they regain weight. And then here we have the exercise group. And that's good news that the exercise group were able to maintain their body weight in that period. So here you have a piece of advice. With liraglutide, we got exactly the same kind of results as I showed you already. So it works. It maintains the weight loss. And you perhaps can even have a little bit more, but it returns, it seems. And then the good news again was that this was the additive effect between exercise and liraglutide. So eventually, we had a really sizable weight loss here. So these are the changes in weight, and you can see from the first, we had this first initial weight loss, and then comes the next weight loss with the combination over here, and these are the differences. So so it really worked. So how good was it? And if we look at the 15% again, that we discussed, remember, 15% weight loss, this was possible in about 50% of these individuals that were on the combined. So that's something. I mean, it works somehow. And you can see it up here also. So fat percentage, that was one of the parameters. And you can see this is interesting because it increases over this maintenance period in the placebo group, decreases with exercise, decreases with liraglutide equally, and a double decrease in the combination group. The interesting thing here is what happened to lean mass and fat mass. And here you can see that in those on the, what happened after the low-calorie diet is that you have a reduction in fat mass and in lean mass. I mean, they always go together. That's a rule. You can't change that. And then in the placebo group, they gained weight, fat mass, and also lean mass, because they must carry this fat mass around, so they gain also lean mass. So exercise increases lean mass, that's good, reduces fat mass, that is even better. The liraglutide only decreases fat mass, so that's not what you could call a healthy weight loss. It is not as good. And the combination then has a big fat loss and no change in lean body mass, which is very good. It should have decreased, of course, because of the decreased weight loss, but it didn't. So it is a kind of healthy weight loss in that way. And then cardiorespiratory fitness is, of course, better with exercise, bad with placebo, and no difference really with liraglutide. A1C, a big drop with liraglutide as expected, but almost as good in the combination group. HOMA, insulin sensitivity here, there's a big change in the beginning and what happens then afterwards. So exercise, nothing significant happens in these groups. And so how did they feel afterwards? Oh, they didn't like to gain weight again. That was not good. Exercise, they don't really like that. Liraglutide, they don't like that either. But the combination was okay. it's the kind of thing. Okay, this was an interesting observation. Liraglutide causes an increase in heart rate. But adding on exercise apparently made that heart rate increase go away. And that is very peculiar, and we have no explanation for that. In principle, it's a bad thing to have an increase in heart rate. So that's something we'll have to think more about. Side effects. Well, nausea, yes, liraglutide, and also combination group, more or less the same. That is a problem. And there's no change in this from what we already know. And decreased appetite. I put this because, this is one of the regular questions when you look for side effects. It's one of the things you must ask. And you say, this is the purpose of the whole thing. But it is also something that people register, and it's something we have to think about. How is it to lose your appetite? If we lose our appetite, how do we go about? I mean, that would be terrible. We would feel sick. I've lost my appetite. Well, okay, I would, that's for sure. Diarrhea, there was quite a number of people with diarrhea here, but it subsided again, as usual. And vomiting, that was a bit of an... Vomiting is not innocent, it's not good. So there are problems by adding in something like liraglutide, but it is in the beginning, and Steen, I'm sure, can tell much more about it, what happened. Eventually, they were not too unhappy about these side effects, but they are there. So the conclusion is that the diet-induced weight loss was maintained with exercise and liraglutide, and weight was further reduced with the combined treatment. The combined treatment additively improved healthy weight loss, and this has to do with the fat mass versus the lean body mass, and also the health benefits of oxygen uptake or both treatments. And then I ask, this is not the conclusion of the study, and this was not what Signe Thorkov said, but I say, how do we implement these benefits in daily life? And that's consistent with the letters that we are receiving now from the New England Journal readers. They say, well, okay, yeah, that's okay with you, but how do we do this? Here is one little bit of piece of help, perhaps, that semaglutide now is available as a tablet, and that could help. Might be easier, particularly for this group of people that are perhaps a little bit concerned about their condition. So that might help. The problem is, as Steen already alluded to, and this is a slide that I borrowed from Steen, is the distribution in the body of exercise. So how is it distributed among the population? And the problem is that most people don't exercise at all. There are some crazy athletes and some joggers here, but most people have lousy oxygen uptakes and exercise fitness. So this is probably 20 again, as the group I just showed. That's a real, real problem. So what do we do about that? Well, this is my favorite slide of all, and I always showed it to the students because there's no doubt that this guy is highly motivated to stand up and do something about this situation, right? But he can't. He cannot do it. That's the real problem. So what do we do? Here's the solution. This is a study, or a couple of studies here, initiated by Bente Stalknecht, who's now the vice rector of Copenhagen University. And what she did was to compare 6 months of active bike commuting with leisure time exercise. So physically inactive, healthy women and men, 20 to 45 years, with overweight obesity, 130 were randomized to no intervention controls, active commuting, they had to bike to work, or leisure time exercise of moderate or vigorous intensity. And the result was insulin sensitivity, cardiorespiratory fitness, and intra-abdominal fat, as well as fat mass, improved about equally in bike and vigorous intensity. So here's the solution. Change your lifestyle, not to sit there on a stupid bicycle ergometer or ergometer, but to take your bike and go to work on your bike. So make sure when you buy your next flat or house that it is within biking distance from your work. That's the solution. Thank you. And these are all the people that did the work.
Great, Jens, and thank you, and congratulations to the nine paper with the S-Slide study. That was really impressive, I think. Any questions for Jens? Let's start with you, Mads.
It's only about a question about the weight loss that you see when exercising compared to when having 3 milligrams of liraglutide. Can you see any shape difference in the person that loses weight?
Yep, but as you can see, that one was dominated by the loss of fat mass, that was the liraglutide, whereas the other one is, you know, a combination of an increased lean body mass and a smaller decrease in fat mass. So there's a difference, a clear difference. Yes.
Following.
Thank you, very impressive. And just to ask you to elaborate a little bit or speculate a little bit on the future now, just as the letters that are coming to you, do you actually see this translate into a change in yeah, I mean, who's going to provide this treatment? Is this for primary care physicians? I mean, these people are not really diagnosed with anything, right? So they're not in any outpatient clinic and so on.
So Arne Astrup, you know, I'm sure you all know Arne Astrup, the obesity professor, as they called him in ATS at Tinkersheim. So he gave talks in the United States several times on how to solve or deal with the obesity problems. And he said, rebuild your cities. That was the answer, you know. Rebuild your cities so that you don't have to use that goddamn car all the time, but have to do walk or use your bicycle. So that was his advice. And I think it's a good one. It's tough.
But you don't see this as something, a treatment to be provided for everyone that would like to have it?
So things have changed, I think. 30 years ago, when you were taking the elevator at the Panem Institute and traveling with some students, you could hear them talk about how many beers they have been drinking during the weekend. That was all they talked about. And now they talk about how many kilometers they've been running during the weekend. So there is a difference. I mean, there's hope out there. But
But there is still, you know, there are much more knowledge now. Your students, they run and bicycle more.
All the time.
They drink less beer. And we know about these new treatments, but still we see obesity rates going up all around the world. There's no basically exception.
So they are flattening out in some societies and in some social classes,
well,
as you know.
That's if you're
and
really
it's the
positive.
Usual stuff we are having these... No, so I mean, but it doesn't solve the groups in the society where you still see the increase. I'm absolutely.
But if you look at the numbers in Denmark, for instance, they continue to increase. A bigger proportion of the Danes are becoming obese. More and more of our kids are becoming obese.
Yeah.
So still. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, there was a question down here.
Thank you, Jens, for a very nice talk and very impressive study. In terms of the energy intake maintenance. In terms of exercise and also the additional effect of exercise, do you think that the weight reduction or maintenance is accounted for or attributed to the excess of energy during exercise, or does exercise regulate your appetite?
That is a very good question, and we've been involved in numerous studies about this. There was this idea that some exercise would reduce your appetite. I don't think it's been substantiated. You know, it's there are studies saying yes, there are studies saying no, and we've measured all the appetite regulating hormones in these studies, and some studies they go up and some studies they go down. Difficult. You know, also myokines that would regulate appetite and things that, like that, IL-6 and what have you. It hasn't really paid off so far. It's possible.
Did you also look into other biochemical parameters like liver markers, lipids?
So this study is far from finished, and you know there are samples in all Steen's freezers, and there is also shit and things like that. So there's not a detail in the life of these people that we will not be able to address. The biopsies were taken from all sorts of tissues, and you know, endless measurements. Even epigenetics, semen samples were also collected. Yeah.
Wow. I think you need to redo the bike study with electric bikes, because all people use them now.
Yeah. I won't.
I have one question from the chat from Matthias Reed Larsen, who says for both liraglutide groups, the weight seems to increase slightly, 2 kilos, from week 26 to week 52. Why is that? He understands that the weight increase for exercise alone as lean mass would account for that.
Yeah, so there's this little, as we call it, hockey stick shape of the curve. And that's something that we don't know. It's probably some built-in problem in us, in human beings, you know. So it's in the brain, I'm sure.
Yeah, Mads?
Thank you. Thank you, Jens, for a nice presentation. Do you think that one solution for some patients could be that we as doctors would be able to prescribe exercise, you know, visits with a physiotherapist or some kind of training program alongside the liraglutide prescription?
Not really. No. And one of the reasons for saying this in a little bit of a strict manner is there is so much money being spent from the public on all these initiatives that should make people, you know, healthier and do more. Blah, blah, blah. And they're all wasted, mainly. And particularly in the U.S., they're crying all the time because the money could have been directed to some research initiatives and better improve the knowledge, but it goes to completely futile exercises, you know, futile things that people do. So that's the problem. So we have to do it. We have to think in a new way, and I really recommend building in the necessary exercise, because I think it is a good idea in the daily life. That, I think, is important, you know. Drop all these elevators, and when the young ones want money for their fitness club, say, go out there and make some of your money on your own by carrying newspapers around, you know, that kind of thing. That helps. That's a good idea. So that's how we have to think. And that will have a great take up in the entire society, I think, because who doesn't want a little bit of money, of course.
But Jens, that's one side of the story. What about the other side, talking into diet? Because, you know, calories are becoming cheaper and cheaper in the supermarkets.
Yeah, but so this was dual, right? I mean, it was dual. It was trying to address the hunger business with
yeah, but society-wise.
Inhibition. Yeah.
I mean, it's cheaper to buy Coca-Cola than water in the supermarket.
Yeah, and all this discussion about whether the glucose-free, the artificial sweetness. In general, I think that, you know, to choose artificial sweetness is a good idea. But I hate to go into the fight between all the mothers that, you know, say that this is dangerous. But from a pure obesity point of view, that is a good thing.
Yeah, compared to sugary sweet
yes,
stuff.
Exactly.
But why not water instead?
Okay, that's not my business.
All right, before we move on, there is room for one more question to Jens, if any. And if it's not the case, then once again, thank you very much
and
for your
participation.
Steen's work.
Yes.
And now we're moving on to Sten. And before we heard a lot about the responses of all the GI hormones to the surgical operations. And yes. Now we're going to see how the pharmaceutical industry has kind of translated that into medications. Yes. Go ahead, Sten.
Yes, I agree, Philip, but I can put on a comment in relation to the slide study. It shows how difficult it is. You know, it was a placebo controlled study, and the placebo group has exactly the same treatment as the other three groups, and it was treated and seen in outpatient clinic more than once per month. And despite this very, very extensive treatment and advices, the weight gain was 6.1 kilos after 1 year. And now we are doing a follow-up on all the patients, and most have gained weight and is back where they started for some years ago. So obesity is probably the most depressing disease to treat, I think, and it has always been it. But it seems to change now. Until recently, then the history of the obesity drugs have been a story of adverse events, cardiovascular diseases, psychiatric diseases, including depression. If you remember the CP1 antagonist, one of the side effects was that 45% of the patients taking the drugs had severe depression. We have patients in psychiatric hospital for months when we use this drug. Another problem was that weight loss was only about 4 to 6 kilos, and it's not enough for a patient. In all the guidelines we have, you've always been, until recently, suggested that if the patient can treat lost 3 to 5 kilos, this would be okay. But in all the new guidelines, the recommendation is now 5 to 10%, and in the very obese patient, you have to lose 10 to 20% if you have any long-term effect of the weight loss. Let's take. We only have one drug at the market in Denmark and probably in most of Europe at the moment, which is used is the liraglutide 3 mg, which was used in the SLIDE study. And here you can see one of the longest obesity study in the world because it's a 3-year study. And FDA now recommend that the obesity study should at least be of 1 year's duration. But here you can see what happens. You have a nice weight loss in the beginning, and then it level off after 1 year, and then the patient start to gain weight again. And you can see it's the lifestyle treatment, and in all obesity treatment, the weight loss is always only 2 to 3 kilos in the placebo group only receiving weight loss. But you can also see the difference is only about 5 to 6 kilos, and it's not enough when you have a drug which have a cost of about 80 to 90 Danish crown per day to use. You can also see when you stop the treatment and look at the patient 3 weeks later, they all started to gain weight again. Then, of course, when you treat obesity, you always have to look at the patient who lose weight. If a patient have not lose weight after 2 to 3 weeks, then stop the treatment at once. And one thumb rule is that if your patient have not lose 5% in weight after 3 to 4 months, then stop the treatment and forgot it. Patient will not lose weight. And if you use this thumb rule, then you can see that after 1 year, there was with Saxenta, liraglutide 3 mg, a weight loss of about 12 kilo on the average. This is one of the most optimal treatment you can give today. But again, after 3 years, there's a relapse of the weight, and the difference to the placebo group is not great enough. Then we have semaglutide. We use it to treatment of type 2 diabetic at the moment, and you can see here if you go up on 1 mg, then the weight loss is about 6%. But as in all other studies, there's a normal variance in the weight loss. Some patients do not lose weight, and in other patients, we have to go down to 0.5 mg because the patient have lost 30 to 40 kilos. And what happens when the patient is coming to the outpatient clinic? Oh, they have been referred to the gastroenterologist to have gastro investigation and colon investigation because of the weight loss. Because of the weight loss, it's too big. So the GPs are referring the patient for further investigations because of the weight loss. But the average is about 6% for the patient. But what do the patient want? The patient do not want to lose 5% in weight. If you ask your patient, obesity patient, well, how much do you think, how much do you want to lose weight? Then the answer is about 30 kilos. And it has until today been completely unrealistic. 5% have been what you can obtain. You can see here we have some obesity trials illustrating that. But what will we have on the market during the next 1, 2, 3 years? I will show you that. We will already this year have what is named Ozempic Forte. It's 2 milligrams of semaglutide. We use 1 milligram at the moment. The price is 30 to 35 Danish crowns per day. So we look forward to see what will semaglutide Forte cost in the treatment of type 2 diabetes patients. Here you can see the study results. The study is not accepted for publication at the moment, but you can see the further reduction in hemoglobin A1c was only about 0.3%. It's not much, only about 0.3%. And look at the weight loss, surprisingly small difference from 1 to 2.4 milligram. But you have to remember that a type 2 patient always lose less in weight than non-diabetic patient. We do not have the exact explanation of this phenomenon. But now I will give you some example. We will see that the semaglutide 2.4, it will be as an injection, but it's also in phase 3 now as a tablet, as Jens already mentioned. I will give you some example of a GLP-1 GIP dual agonist, Lilly's, and then we have a new drug. It's also just at the moment going in phase 3. It's a combination of GLP-1 and amylin from Novo Nordisk. It's giving excellent results, as I will show you. Then we have the GLP-1 and glucagon dual agonist, Sanofi. I'll give you some results from the Sanofi drug. Novo Nordisk also have one. And I realized yesterday that there's a lot of GLP-1 glucagon dual agonist published about. Well, the idea, as I'll show you, is that maybe it will be excellent for fat liver treatment. Then we have the GLP-1 PYY dual agonist inspired by the gastric bypass surgery, and then we have the triple agonist. Okay, here we have 2.4 milligram semaglutide, and it's the phase 3 program. We have the SELECT study. It's 7,500 obese patients who are included in this cardiovascular endpoint study. All the inclusion has been finished, and we are just waiting for the results now. And then the drug was released in US for a week ago, and here you have the name Wegovy for this Ozempic 2.4 milligram. And you can see here we have the uptitration of the drug, and it takes in fact about 20 weeks before you are in steady state for the 2.4 milligram. And here we have, just show you results from 2 studies. Here we have the step 1 trial, quite simple, obese patient, it's without diabetes, randomized to SEMA 2.4 or placebo treatment. And then you can see this is the intention to treat data, and this is the pair protocol data. We have to use the left side. You can see you have a reduction in 15% in weight with semaglutide 2.4. And it's the biggest weight loss we have seen until today with the drug. Then we have what I think is a very interesting study. We have a step 4 trial. We have 20 weeks with uptitration of semaglutide to 2.4 milligram. Then the patient become randomized to semaglutide or placebo treatment and follow for 1 year. And what happens then? Yes, you can see here, you lose after 20 weeks about 10% weight, and then you continue to lose when you continue with semaglutide. But again, exactly as in the slide study, when you are treated with placebo, you will gain weight, about 6 kilo, exactly as in the slide study. This slide also illustrates that if you want to look on the drug, the effectiveness of the drug, and if the drug can lose about 18 to 10, 20% in body weight, then the study at least have to be 1 year to, of duration. Here you can see 6.9 kilos weight gain in the placebo group, 7.9 further weight loss, and in total 17% in weight loss in the active treated group. Excellent results. As Jensen mentioned, then oral semaglutide is now going into phase 3, and normally we stop at 14 milligrams in a type 2 patient, but now the uptitration will continue to 50 milligrams, and here is some mathematical model. No think that you will obtain at least the same as the semaglutide in relation to weight loss. So oral semaglutide at weight loss medication will be a clinical reality probably within a few years. Then we have the dual and the triple agonist. Here you can see GLP-1 and glucagon. Why use it? It takes your appetite, you eat less, you lose weight, it increases energy expenditure, it has beneficial effect on liver fat, and then of course you can stimulate insulin and thereby improve glycemic control. This is the GLP-1 glucagon agonist from Sanofi. It stopped now, and also know that Novo Nordisk has also stopped the dual agonist because of side effect. And the side effect with this drug was nausea. Nausea, I can tell you. But you can see here it was not so effective. It started off the hemoglobin A1C, and then after 46 weeks, 2.6, and it's compared with liraglutide, Victoza 1.8 milligram, nearly the same. And here we have the placebo treatment. You can see just to participate in the trial, you will be better. You will be better regulated. And here we have the weight loss, about five kilos. And here you can see it's the disposition index and index of beta cell function. And you can see it looks like it's improved beta cell function more than liraglutide, but this differences in disposition index is explained by the improvement in hepatic insulin sensitivity. So when you calculate the disposition index, the beta cell function is the same, but the disposition index will increase. What about GLP-1 DIP dual agonist? We have already heard about it from Jens, and you have the appetite regulation, and you have the improvement in glycemic control, and because of DIP, you also hope to have some effect on the lipid metabolism. And we'll only show you one study. It's the SURPASS 2 trial. And if any interesting in this drug, then it will be presented 28 this month in US between 8 and 10. But in Denmark, it will be between 14 to 16 in the afternoon. I show this, this study because it's compared with semaglutide. Here you have your uptitration, and the 5, 10, and 15 milligram is compared with semaglutide 1 milligram. And here we have the results, and again, this is over here we have to look, it's the last observation carried forward, and you can see even the lowest dose, 5 milligram, is doing better than semaglutide 1 milligram, which is very surprising. 2.3% reduction in hemoglobin A1C is 25 millimole per mole. And you can see the baseline hemoglobin A1C was 8.3, indicating that more than 50% is going below 6. And you can see here that it's about 40% is going below 5.7, is going into the normal range in hemoglobin A1C. And again, it beats semaglutide. And here we have the changes in body weight, and you can see the changes, I think it has disappeared, but it's about 11 to 12 kilo for the highest dose. But even the lowest dose here is doing better than semaglutide. In relation to the side effect, it's the normal the one for GLP-1. It's nausea, it's vomiting, and also more patients in the tirzepatide group has to stop the treatment. Normally in the GLP-1 studies in type 2 patients and in other studies, it's about 10% who has to stop the treatment in the studies. What about amylin? Amylin is, you can maybe remember, secreted from the beta cells in the pancreas, and it also have an effect on appetite regulation. And here you have some unpublished data from the phase two trial. It's called cagrilintide, and you can see it's a dose response study, and there's a comparator, it's liraglutide, Saxenta, 3 milligram daily. This cagrilintide is for once weekly administration. And here you have the data. You cannot see how effective the drug is because the patient is still losing weight after 26 weeks. You see 10.8% over here and 9% with liraglutide, 3.0 milligram. And of course, you have to subtract the 3% from the placebo treated group. But no one else was so happy about the results, so they decided to compare cagrilintide and semaglutide in one treatment. And the first phase one data was published for a few weeks ago. It's now in phase three, I can tell you, ongoing. But here we have some phase one studies, and you can see here it's a combination. It's a dose response study with increasing doses of amylin, but all this semaglutide 2.4. And the most simple figure is over here. Here we have the weight loss with semaglutide alone, and here we have the combination drug, and it is quite obviously that it's going down to 15% within 20 weeks on the average, and where it will stop is at present unknown. The same data presented in another way. What about the side effect? It's nausea, the usual one. 73 has a side effect at the highest dose, nausea. And of course, there is the usual one, nausea and vomiting is another side effect of this drug. It's now in phase three and ongoing in obesity, in general obesity, in type 2 diabetes patient, and is a long-term study for more than 1 year to see what is the effectiveness of this combination drug. And here we have the pen used in the studies. Then what about the three agonists? I have not seen any studies in humans with three agonists, but I heard now that there will be presentation at the ADA meeting from Eli Lilly with three agonists. So it would be of interest, but of course you will have an effect on appetite, energy expenditure, liver, fat metabolism, insulin secretion, and maybe also in the peripheral fat tissue. And here are some review, or you can see there's a lot of companies having GLP-1 and glucagon dual agonist, also you have the GIP and the GLP-1 agonist, and here we have the Lilly agonist up here, and then we have the triple agonist, which, as I heard just from a moment ago, that there will be some data presented at the ADA. Other drugs in pipeline is a selective PYY analog for the U2 receptor, and there's a GOAT inhibitor, which now is investigated to block the effect of ghrelin, is in phase one. Oxyntomodulin is in phase two at the moment. The weight loss in the first phase two study was about 9 kilos, I can tell you, after a half year. And then we have the triple agonist, where we have some short-term mechanistic studies. So I think this gap we have had between lifestyle and then the bariatric surgery is now disappearing. And when we reach about 20%, 25% in weight loss using drugs, then I think the use of bariatric surgery will decrease rather fast. And my final slide would be that I think during the next 1 to 2 years, weight loss of about 20% will be possible. And I also think the SELECT study with 70,500 participants will change the indication for semaglutide 2.4. But we also have to realize that the treatment has to be lifelong to be effective, and the treatment will be extremely expensive. And that's a background for that Novo Nordisk now use so much energy and so much money trying to have obesity to become a disease, what it not is in Denmark. You know, it's a disease in US and in Canada, but not in Denmark. So that's, I think, what we will have on the market during the next about 4 to 5 years.
Thank you very much, Sten. There will be a lot to talk about in the future.
Yes, yes, yes. Maybe obesity will be interesting to treat again.
So so it seems like the majority of the weight loss with all these compounds still, you know, are from centrally mediated effects. And still the majority of the compounds are also peptide-based.
Yes.
But there are some small molecule GLP-1 receptor agonists also. Do you think they will interact differently with central GLP-1 receptors as compared to the peptide?
I have not seen any data on that question with cars. But we know that, as an example, GLP-1 can pass the blood-brain barrier and interact with receptors in the brain. So I think it's an interesting question. But you know, all the previous drugs we have had, it has been central acting drugs. And I think the area of the central acting drugs, which change the metabolism in the brain, has completely finished now.
Are you, you know, these drugs, when they interact with the receptors in the brain, they also interact with the reward system.
Yes.
There are also other ways to interact with the reward centers. You know, the porn industry, the gambling industry, yes. And so on. So, I was thinking about the price of these compounds.
Yes.
You showed some women losing around 5 kilograms over a period of 3 years on Saxenda.
Yes.
That corresponds to some rough calculation into 100,000 kroner.
Yes.
Do you know of any trials, you know, suggesting these women to lose weight by giving them 10,000 kroner per kilogram?
Yes,
they lost?
There has been such a study for some years ago. And
did it work?
The participants lose weight when they was paid in relation to how much they lose weight. But when you stop the payment, then they regain the weight. You know, that's a problem with obesity. That is a lifelong relapsing condition which makes it so difficult to treat.
Okay, questions for Sten? Mads?
Thank you very much, Sten, for this nice presentation. I have a question regarding weight loss in specialized patients, because I'm a nephrologist and we do kidney transplantations.
Yes.
And we have a really large population that increase weight, typically starting right after transplantation and being the most 1 year after transplantation. And we have a problem with pre-diabetes, with diabetes evolution after transplantation.
Yeah.
And none of these drugs are tested in patients on immunosuppressive drugs. Do you have a good explanation on that? Because we have asked several companies, why don't you do a control trial to demonstrate the superiority of, for example, a GLP-1-based treatment to reduce weight in these patients that would actually increase the success both of their transplant but also on their diabetes disease.
It's correctly. In relation to the GLP-1 receptor agonist, we only have two small studies looking at patients with severe impaired kidney function. I think your department was doing one of the studies, and that's the background for we now use a GLP-1 receptor agonist in a patient in dialysis and so on. But I agree, the post-transplantation diabetes and so on is a problem. I think the explanation of why the companies are not doing trial is that the population is too small. But in fact, they could only perform a rather small trial, trial looking at the side effect and security. So I agree. It is a problem which drugs should be used in patients in immunosuppressive treatment. And most of the patients is then treated with insulin and then the weight gain anymore. Mm-hmm. So, but I will, if I have a problem, then I would use a GLP-1 receptor agonist. I would not be so nervous.
In a related question, patients who with end-stage kidney disease who are on dialysis and who are very overweight and so overweight that they can't undergo kidney transplantation. Are GLP-1 receptor agonists, is that a possible treatment for them, or is there some other weight loss treatment for them, so they, because often they need to lose enough weight that they can undergo the surgery, and obviously it would be best if they maintain weight loss, but the most important thing is that they lose enough weight that they can undergo the surgery and then they can gain the weight again afterwards, if you like.
You know, if you look at the label, then the lower limit for when you can use a GLP-1 receptor agonist is an estimated GFR of 15 after the labeling. But I have a lot of patients I treat with Ozempic, which is treated with dialysis and so on. But in relation to the question you asked, then I think if some nephrologists was going together, then it's possible to make a grant application in what is named in Novo Nordisk investigator-initiated studies. This slide was an investigator-initiated study by the Panum and the Hvidovre Hospital. So it could be a possibility. But you know, the company is very nervous because what they not wanted is to have new adverse effects. That's why they're always saying no, no. And you can never have an obesity drug before it has a full approval.
But Thomas Edorn from Mass's department, now he's with Novo Nordisk, but he actually made that study with liraglutide treatment of dialysis-treated patients. And what he saw was that the concentration in the circulation of a liraglutide is a little bit higher in these patients, and that translates into a little bit more side effects. So I think if you decide to use GLP-1 receptor agonists in such patients, you should just be aware that they will probably be a little bit more susceptible to the side effects and use a little smaller dose.
It's correct.
Off-label.
The concentration was about 30% higher in the dialysis patient compared with the controlled patient. But when you use a GLP-1 receptor agonist, it's always clever to perform a very slow uptitration. And maybe one of you patients only needed 0.9 milligram of Victoza or 1.2 milligram. And I think it's a clever thing to start with Victoza because of the short half-life. In relation to semaglutide, we were using it in too high doses when we started to use it. And therefore, we have a patient which we have to take to the hospital for days because he was vomiting so much. It will never be a problem with liraglutide because when you stop the treatment, 12 hours later, there's no more GI side effect. So I will start with liraglutide, and when it's going well, so try 0.25 milligram of sema and then perform a slow uptitration. Also with the semaglutide, you can perform what we name microtitration. You do not need to go from 0.25 to 0.5. You can perform microtitration.